Yes. Please say a few words.
Good morning, everyone.
Yeah, stay on. I'll just share the link with everyone and then we'll start soon. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Anand. Come back.
Hi, good morning.
Yeah, good morning. Shall we start?
Yes, please. I'm ready.
You're live.
Okay. Can I start?
I'll just interview.
Sure, sure.
I'm done. Okay, hello audience, welcome. This is a special webinar that we have arranged in view of the COVID-19 situation. I'm Dr. Aditya Agnihotri. I'm a professor at SDM Medical College, Dharwad, and I'm glad to extend a warm welcome for the second KCRPM PATH webinar. And this webinar will be presented by Dr. Anand Vikas J. Jairam from Anand Newberg Reference Laboratory, Bangalore. And we'll be presenting this talk on the pathologist and the COVID. Okay, so before we begin, we are happy to also share that our KCRPM SOMI YouTube channel has also crossed 1,000 subscribers. And it's growing very fast and it's currently at 1350. So we thank all the subscribers for that and hope to continue serving great content. If you haven't subscribed to our channel, please do it. Okay, and please set your resolution at the maximum possible and 480 pixels so that you get a good resolution. So I'm joined by live by Dr. Anand Vikas Ji, who will be starting the presentation. Anand, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Aditya.
Welcome to the meeting. Please start your webinar.
First of all, good morning to all of you. Hope you're all staying safe at home and are doing well in this time of the pandemic. So I would also like to thank KCRPM and Dr. Aditya for giving me this opportunity to share some of my views and on the work that we've done on COVID-19. So over the next 30 to 40 minutes or so, I'll just take you through what we know of COVID-19 so far, what's the role of the laboratory in this pandemic situation, and take you through the testing strategy, starting from how do we select cases, how do we collect samples, and what are the different testing, the ancillary testing that we can do. Then what are the COVID-related findings that we can come across in our routine practice? And how has the COVID and the lockdown affected a pathologist practice? So what is COVID-19? COVID-19 was the term given to the disease caused by the virus. The virus was initially termed as a 2019 novel coronavirus or the 2019 nCoV. But later on, it was officially renamed as a severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2, which is the SARS-CoV-2. And this is the accepted terminology as of now. This virus has its origin in the Wuhan city of Hubei province. Currently, almost 60-80% of those that are infected with the virus are asymptomatic. So this is very important to remember. I'll tell you why. The main routes of spread so far are contact and droplet spread. Just to put the same thing in a timeline, December 30th, 2019 was when a cluster of cases of pneumonia of unknown origin was reported to the China National Health Commission. On Jan 7th, 2020, the novel coronavirus was isolated. On Jan 11th, the first fatality was reported. Then you can see that the first case outside of China was reported in Thailand on Jan 13th. So it's spread quite fast. So what are coronaviruses? Coronaviruses have been around for some time. They're enveloped, non-segmented, positive sense RNA viruses. And the name corona comes from the crown-like appearance that it gives under an electron microscope. And the crown is because of the spike projections that you can see here. Coronaviruses can be broadly classified into four genera, alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. The SARS-CoV-2 that we're dealing with now is a beta coronavirus. So this is what it looks like under the electron microscope. This has been artificially colored, and this is a digital rendering of the same. A little bit of history. Coronaviruses were known to have infected humans. HKU1, NL63, OC43, and 229E are believed to cause very mild symptoms, including something like a common cold, very rarely viral pneumonia. And only in the recent past, two of these viruses have been known to cause quite severe disease. The first was the SARS in 2002, and then the MERS in 2012. And both of these had documented evidence of crossover from animals to humans, mainly from the bats to humans. In 2002, the SARS, which spread mostly in the areas of China and Hong Kong and surrounding areas, affected around 8,000 people. The fatality was almost up to 10%. In 2012, similarly, MERS was in the Middle East, and then it affected around 2,500 people. This is interesting because the numbers that we're seeing of the novel coronavirus or SARS-CoV-2 is almost in the lakhs or almost nearing the millions. That is because the fatality rate in SARS-CoV-2 isn't nearly as high as what it was in SARS or MERS. So people aren't dying with the virus, and hence the virus is able to replicate, and we are spreading the virus a lot more. This is again a nice documentary that recently came out on Netflix. If any of you have a Netflix subscription or you have friends who have this, you please watch it. It's nice. It's a short one, and it's still evolving. So how do patients present with the COVID-19? Symptoms may appear between 2 to 14 days after being infected. This is the incubation period of the virus. And according to the CDC, persons who are infected generally have mainly cough and breathlessness, or at least any two of the following symptoms, including fever, chills, muscle pain, headache, sore throat, and a new onset of loss of taste or smell. So these have been highlighted by the CDC. So next, coming to what is the role of a laboratory? Once a patient is suspected to have a COVID-19, what does a laboratory need to do? First of all, we need to confirm the presence of SARS-CoV-2 in this patient by various modalities of testing. Immediately, if it is not SARS-CoV-2 and it's still suspected or it's looking like a SARS-CoV-2, then what could it be? We also need to be involved in training and facilitating proper sample collection. Pre-analytics plays a huge role. We need to be able to define the roles of testing modalities in the pandemic, because we have various testing modalities available. We need to be the ones who will educate and communicate the right way of doing things. We need to ensure the safety of our own staff. We need to ensure sample integrity and safe disposal of the biomedical waste. We also have a role in participating in the data management and contributing to epidemiology and public health in these times. We also have a huge role in reporting to government agencies on the results that we get, along with the demographics, so that these areas can be quarantined or handled accordingly. So coming to the COVID-19 testing per se, I'll take this in under these three headings. The first is the pre-analytics, which includes sample collection, storage and transportation, and how do we handle samples in the lab. Then a brief overview of the testing methodologies and how we identify the viruses, antibodies to viruses, or changes caused by the infection. And then how do we handle biomedical waste in these scenarios. So the first question is, who needs to be swabbed? The guidelines are provided by the Indian Council of Medical Research, and this is the appropriate state government authority. And this is the latest version of the guideline, which was released on 9th April 2020. So initially it was said that all symptomatic individuals who have undertaken international travel in the last 14 days. And as of 9th April, that was obsolete because the lockdown was already in effect. So it's been modified as below, where all symptomatic individuals who have undertaken travel in the last 14 days to hotspot or containment zones. The second is the all symptomatic contacts of a laboratory confirmed case, all symptomatic health workers, all patients with a SARI or a severe acute respiratory illness, which is defined as fever and cough and or shortness of breath. The only instances where asymptomatic individuals would need to be tested are those with high risk direct or indirect contact with a positive case, and only these need to be tested between 5th and 14th day after exposure. The recommendation is on the 12th day post exposure. And COVID positive who has been quarantined or isolated, we need to have two swabs that have tested negative 24 hours apart. So these are the only guidelines that have been put forth by the ICMR. So once we know who needs to be swabbed, how do we collect samples? There are two main things. Mainly the samples where we get good yield of viruses are the respiratory tract samples. So it could either be lower respiratory tract like bronchoalveolar lavage or sputum, or from the upper respiratory tract where it's either a nasopharyngeal or an oropharyngeal swab. There was an interesting comparison in the JAMA recently, where they compared the yield of viruses in different samples, and superior to oropharyngeal swabs or nasopharyngeal swabs rather. But the bronchoalveolar lavage is the one that gives the highest yield. Of course, we can't resort to bronchoalveolar lavage fluid collection in asymptomatic individuals. So probably only those who are in the ICU or hospitalized because of SARI, we can even rely on BAL fluid. The interesting thing about sputum is that it can be got only in symptomatic patients with productive cough. But there's a huge risk of aerosols when giving the sample, so it's best avoided. It's also the fact that very often when we get sputum samples, it's heavily contaminated with saliva. So sputum is generally not recommended. Now, how do we collect the nasopharyngeal swab? The direction of swabbing is very important. If we go straight, we hit the cribriform plane and get a good enough sample. The direction of sampling should be parallel to the palate so that we reach the nasopharynx, and this is where the best yield of viruses comes, in the upper respiratory tract. So we should not be going this way or this way. We should ideally go parallel to the palate. There are two types of swabs that are generally provided. One is a thin swab, which is flexible. This is for the nasopharyngeal. The other is a thick swab, which is for the oropharyngeal. And ideally, both of these need to be put into the same container of the viral transport media so that we don't lose out on the virus. So why are we stressing so much on the sampling? Because false negatives because of improper sampling completely changes the picture. We'll be presuming that somebody is negative where actually they're negative because of improper sampling. So sampling plays a huge role. So once we've sampled, or even during sampling, how do we ensure safety of the operator? So the CDC has given a nice cartoon where they give the ideal scenario of preferred PPUs, where they recommend face shield or goggles, an N95 or a higher respirator, clean non-sterile gloves, and an isolation gown. they also say that in view of shortage of N95 masks, when it's not available, face masks are an accepted alternative. So face masks or surgical masks are an accepted alternative to N95 masks. There's also an interesting table which also tells you about the level of PPE that is required depending on the area of work. So N95 masks, hazmat suits and goggles are required only for those entering isolation wards or ICUs or areas where COVID-19 patients are being treated, or a CT scan room where it's scanning COVID-19 patients, or labs testing COVID-19 samples. So these are the only three areas where N95 masks are required. If somebody is entering a hospital where COVID patients are admitted or being treated, but not entering the COVID-19 ward itself, N95 mask is not required. What's also interesting is that they note that the N95 mask is to be used wherever there is a chance of aerosol generation, such as intubation and so on. So once we've collected the sample and ensured its safe transport, let's come to the testing. The entire testing process for diagnosis, for monitoring, mainly it is RT-PCR. There's no other modality. Antibody testing for SARS-CoV-2 antibodies has a role only in epidemiological surveillance. It does not have a role in diagnosis of the infection. This is also a nice cartoon where it shows the rate of detection using the different methods. Now, using RNA RT-PCR, this is the blue line. Right from day 5, it can be detected. IgM comes only after day 7 and it's lost by day 21. IgG comes by day 14 and provides long-term immunity. Now, coming to RT-PCR. RT-PCR is nothing but a reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. It's used to detect the RNA virus. This is currently the accepted standard of care and the accepted diagnostic testing platform. The best yields are got from respiratory samples, as I mentioned before. Now, for some of you who may not be familiar with RT-PCR, just a brief overview. You have the RNA that is converted to a cDNA. cDNA is double strand. Then you have two primers, which are specific to sequences of the novel coronavirus. And you have a probe which is also specific to that particular sequence. Once the PCR starts, the primer moves towards the probe, and once it reaches the area of the probe, the fluorescent signal is got. Now, the amount of fluorescent signal is directly proportional to the number of copies of the cDNA and indirectly the number of copies of RNA that are there in the sample. So it's telling us how much of the actual viral RNA is there in the sample. So some of the pros of RT-PCR is that it's a definitive diagnosis of a virus, of the presence of virus. It can go to as low as 1 to 2 copies of the virus in the sample. Earlier detection than serology, we don't miss the window period. And with the use of standards of known concentration, we can even get a viral load. Some of the disadvantages are that it's expensive. We need complicated instrumentation and reagents. Not everybody can do an RT-PCR, you need specialized training for this, and it's not rapid in that sense where it takes almost up to 8 hours or sometimes 24 hours. So some of the genes and targets that we look for in RT-PCR are these, which is the E gene, the RDRP gene, the N gene, ORF1AB and the S gene. The E gene is a purely screening test, which is because it is not specific to SARS-CoV-2. It is shared by all beta coronaviruses. So it's been relegated to the realm of only a screening test. It codes for the E protein, which is abundantly expressed inside the infected cell during replication. And it's also incorporated into viral virion envelope. Now, why is the E gene important for the virus? Is because those viruses that lack the E gene have crippled maturation and reduced viral titers. So the E gene implies viability of the virus. RDRP is something that is specific to the SARS-CoV-2 and it codes for an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. Similarly, ORF1AB or ORF stands for open reading frame. This is also specific to the SARS-CoV-2 and this protein gives rise to the RDRP, which I spoke about earlier. And RDRP is what guides replication, transcription and translation of the virus. The N gene or the nuclear capsid gene is another specific or discriminatory gene for the SARS-CoV-2. It is involved in COVID replication and host cellular response to infection. The S gene codes for the spikes that we saw and the ones that give the coronavirus its name. And these are important for viruses to invade the susceptible cells because they are the ones that bind to receptors on the host cell. So once we have looked at these targets, how do we report a RT-PCR result? It's of the internal control to see whether the extraction as well as the PCR have worked. This could either be an endogenous control like an RNA-Sp or an added bacteriophage like an MS2, which is done during the extraction step itself. So once we know that the internal control has worked, we look at the positive and the negative controls and a no template control. A no template control is nothing but the reagent without any addition of a template. It helps us know whether the reagents have been contaminated or not. So as per the directives of the State Department, negative results can be reported directly to the referring hospital or physician. Positive reports have to be released only to the IDSP authorities for action. It cannot be released to the referring hospital as of now. So this is something that has been in the news recently, and some of you may be aware of it. It's called isothermal nucleic acid amplification, or LAMP, which stands for loop mediated isothermal amplification. So this is a relatively new technique than RT-PCR. It's been mostly in the research realm. It's reported to have a much higher sensitivity and specificity than the conventional RT-PCR. It's rapid, and you can get from sample to result in about 1 to 1.5 hours. There's no requirement for a separate or sophisticated extraction process. And Sri Chitra Thirumal was in the news for having developed a very simple LAMP-based kit for SARS-CoV-2. And I think they're awaiting ICMR approval for the same. So if we need to compare LAMP and RT-PCR, RT-PCR is bulky, cumbersome, you need specialized thermal cyclers. Takes about 8 hours till the result to come. We require skilled technicians. We require an additional reverse transcription step, which again adds to the time and the reagents. But it has been tested heavily on patient samples and validated. The LAMP technique is simpler, it's portable. You need only a simple heat block or a simple RT-PCR machine. It takes generally about 1 to 1.5 hours from the sample to result. Not much of specific skills are required. But again, the disadvantage is that we have not validated it on enough patient samples as yet. So after RT-PCR and LAMP, the next thing which a lot of us are familiar about is the CBNAT. CBNAT stands for Cartridge-Based Nucleic Acid Amplification Test. So GeneXpert is one of the trademarks that is available for CBNAT. It's a self-contained extraction and RT-PCR in a single cartridge. What it does is it minimizes the risk of exposure because there's very little manual intervention and handling. The results are comparable to an RT-PCR. The only disadvantage is it works out to be a little more expensive than a conventional RT-PCR. The ICMR has released a one-page guideline on the usage of CBNAT-based testing. One of the last nucleic acid testing platforms that I'll be talking about is what is called as the TrueNAT, which is again a trademark. It is a chip-based PCR where they're only going to detect the E gene of beta coronavirus. So because it's only a screening test, all positive results that come out of a TrueNAT-based PCR assay have to be confirmed on a RT-PCR or a conventional RT-PCR that looks for the more discriminatory genes. There's again a guideline released by the ICMR for the usage of TrueNAT testing. So once we've looked at identification of the virus per se, the other way we can identify the virus is by looking at the immune response mounted by the body to the virus. So these could either be antigen or antibody based. Antigen-based testing, according to the WHO website, may show cross-reactivity with other coronaviruses, and studies have claimed that almost more than 50% of COVID-infected patients may be missed by if we rely only on antibody-based testing. So this is a statement by the WHO where they currently do not recommend the use of antigen-detecting rapid diagnostic tests. Coming to antibodies, we could either detect the presence of IgM or IgG antibodies or both. But majority of patients develop a response or an immune response only about 2 weeks after the symptoms. So when we use antibody testing, we can only identify cases that are in the recovery phase. So opportunities to intervene or stop spread of the of the infection have already passed by the time the person goes into the recovery phase. There is no evidence currently to support whether the presence of antibodies confirms or confers immunity to reinfection. There is also a chance that there could be a cross-reactivity with other coronaviruses, and there are a lot of coronaviruses which we know to cause a common cold as well. But one of the distinct advantages of antibody testing is in the support of development of vaccines and in epidemiology. And in the recent news, we've also seen that plasma therapy is useful, and it relies again on the detection of antibodies in the serum. Again, for diagnosis, the WHO and ICMR do not recommend the use of antibody tests. Antibody tests have again been in the news recently, and these are some of the various articles that have come out. And the ICMR also has a very clear directive on the role of antibody testing. They state that the gold standard frontline test for COVID-19 diagnosis is and only is the real-time PCR molecular test. The rapid antibody test is a supplementary tool to assess the prevalence of disease within a specific area or parameter. And it's only after a minimum of 7 days. So wherever you see criteria for antibody testing, it only talks about cluster or country gatherings or hotspot areas. It cannot be used for diagnostic purposes. So some of the other techniques that have been used, especially I think in China, are to look at changes in the changes on imaging studies that have been caused by the virus, mainly because of viral pneumonia. And bilateral multiple ground glass opacities have been described in a lot of these patients who had SARI because of SARS-CoV-2. Of course, this is non-specific, but it has helped them triage patients for testing and isolation. So what are the ancillary tests that we can do to find evidence to support a COVID-19 testing? We could look at CBC, albumin, LDH, AST, ALT, bilirubin, creatinine, troponin, D-dimer, prothrombin, calcitonin, CRP, ferritin, and interleukin-6. And the variations that are seen are almost all these parameters are increased in SARS-CoV-2, except for albumin, which is decreased, the lymphocyte count, which is reduced, platelet count is reduced, and there's a decrease in the CD4 and CD8 counts. So coming to the CBC, most of the patients that have been described have shown leukopenia and a lymphopenia with a decrease in both CD4s, and there's been a mild thrombocytopenia. There was one paper from Dr. Gina Zini in Italy, which described some morphological changes, which are these, where they described hypergranular cytoplasm, a pseudo-Belgae-like nucleus in the neutrophils, some kind of blastoid or atypical lymphocytes, apoptotic changes in the neutrophils and lymphocytes, and some giant platelets in the smear. Now, changes in our routine practice in a variety of other conditions, but probably in a high index of suspicion case, if we get these findings, I think it warrants an alert to probe further for coronavirus or on SARS-CoV-2 testing. The other thing that I would like to highlight here is the cytokine storm syndrome. We know that majority of the patients with SARS-CoV-2 are asymptomatic, but some of them develop very severe symptoms. So these patients have been hypothesized to have a cytokine storm syndrome. This cytokine storm syndrome occurs due to overproduction of early response pro-inflammatory cytokines, and this causes an increased risk of vascular hyperpermeability and multi-organ failure, ultimately leading to death. So it's very important to screen for markers of hyperinflammation, which includes increasing ferritin, elevated CRP, decreased platelet counts, or an elevated ESR. The cytokine storm syndrome, which is seen in SARS-CoV-2, has been described to be very similar to a secondary hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis-like picture, where we see an increase in the interleukin-2, interleukin-7, granulocyte CSF, interferon gamma inducible protein 10, monocyte chemoattractant protein 1, macrophage inflammatory protein 1 alpha, TNF, interleukin-6. One of the papers from China also described that elevated ferritin and elevated interleukin-6 had a very significant impact on the fatality. So the presence of these two had a significant predictor of the fatality rate, and it's important to look at these. It's also important to identify patients with the cytokine storm syndrome, because these are the patients who will benefit from a corticosteroid therapy. If there is no cytokine storm syndrome, a steroid therapy may actually exacerbate the underlying infection. So once we have tested for SARS-CoV-2 and it's found to be negative, and the patient is a severe, is a SARI or has symptoms or in the ICU, then what is the role of the laboratory? We need to be able to test for other causes of SARI, like influenza-like illnesses, including H1N1 and HCN2, which have a number of cases. We should be able to highlight or test for influenza A or B, mycoplasma, enteroviruses, and other coronaviruses. So generally, other causes of SARI need to also be looked for and evaluated in these cases. And there are some postmortem series which have come out of China mainly, who looked at associated changes in the various organs in patients who have had a COVID-2 and who've succumbed. So they describe injury to alveolar epithelial cells with hyaline membrane formation, type 2 pneumocyte hyperplasia, and consolidation within the lungs. Liver and cardiac changes have also been seen and have been thought to be fairly non-specific, which include lobular inflammation by small lymphocytes, centrilobular sinusoidal dilatation, and patchy necrosis in the liver, the fibrosis and myocardial hypertrophy in the cardiac muscle. The kidney changes have also been described in a different series, which includes diffuse proximal tubule injury with loss of brush pot epithelium, non-isometric vacuolar degeneration areas, and hemosiderin deposition within the tubular epithelium. So these are some of the changes that we may come across in our biopsy practice in cases of COVID-19. These are the two references for these studies. Now, how do we handle biomedical waste? There's a document from the Pollution Control Board regarding this. The summary is that waste generated from COVID-19 testing facility should be discarded separately in clearly labeled bags. So the bags have to be labeled clearly as COVID-19 waste, and they recommend a double layer bag. We must segregate COVID waste from general waste from the source till the end. Samples that are tested, so the negative samples have to be discarded within 1 week of testing, and these have to be disinfected with a 5% hypochlorite before they are discarded. Now, how has COVID-19 changed pathology practice? Tests have shown that there have been positive rates of detection in about 29% of fecal samples and 1% of blood samples. But what's important is to remember is that mere testing of positive of an RNA on RT-PCR does not equate with infectivity, because there are multiple other factors. RNA is not infectious. There could also be cross-contamination at the time of sample collection in the sample collection area. It's also the fact that the virus has been described to be viable on a lot of surfaces, including cardboard, table, glass, and other things, with varying data on the length of viability. So it's best that we regard all samples collected for lab investigations as being potentially infectious. So with respect to the histopathology laboratory, we must ensure that specimens are transported in leak-proof containers. It's also use a secondary outer container to keep that container within. Formalin fixation of 24 hours has been described to inactivate the virus. Surfaces of all the containers that we receive with a disinfectant prior to handling or opening them. And acceptable disinfectants are 70% IPA for 30 seconds or 0.1% hypochlorite for 2 to 3 minutes. When it comes to frozen sections, the guidelines say that frozen sections on patients with confirmed or suspected COVID-19 are not recommended. If fresh unfixed tissue has to be handled, then it's preferably done in a biosafety 2 cabinet. These are recommendations. I know that there are practical difficulties in implementing them, but these are what has been described. Coming to the hematology laboratory, again, any area where there is a potential for aerosol generation or spray, where we are opening off cap tubes, where we would like to make smears or opening the centrifuge, in all these areas, the operators need to ideally be wearing an N95 mask, have eye protection, wear a long sleeve gown and gloves. We should also exercise caution while transporting samples through the pneumatic tube systems, although there is no contraindication to this. In cytology practice, general universal PPE measures have been recommended, but during the procedure where there is again a chance for aerosol generation, like squirting of the sample from the needle onto the slides after an FNA procedure, the operator is recommended to wear an N95 mask, a long sleeve gown, gloves, and then after the procedure, discard all of these into a labeled bag as COVID after each use. They also say that FNA procedures in a known positive case is best avoided. If it is required to be done, then the procedure of preparing the slides is best done within a biosafety 2 cabinet. That was proposed was to use a liquid-based cytology approach in such cases. Now, how has the lockdown affected laboratory practice and the pathologists? These are some of our own views. I think that we've seen a move towards more of healthcare service, home health services, rather than the patient coming to the lab. The lab is trying to go to the patient's house. We've had an opportunity to explore and exploit telepathology and e-learning platforms. I don't think we would have had this webinar if it were not for COVID-19. We've also been kind of forced to look at our man management, to review our processes, to review the utilization of resources, and also bring in a level of financial prudence and discipline into our own practices. And I'm sure a lot of you agree with this. Just to sum up our experience with testing for COVID-19 in our laboratory, we set up the test in the second half of March, and there was a challenge initially in procuring the kits because they were not easily available. We had to adhere to the ICMR and state regulations, and it was a commendable effort by both, huge effort to coordinate the entire country into testing and bring in a uniformity in the testing, and hats off to them. We had to even look at training of our staff. So we had to recruit additional staff from other departments into the molecular lab because huge number of samples were coming in. We had to train them on molecular testing, accessioning of samples, making sure that they don't get lost. Also on the usage of proper PPE, not only the technical staff, even our housekeeping team, which looks at the molecular lab, had to be trained in the use of proper PPE and to ensure there's a whole array of extraction and PCR kits are being available, different technologies, different companies. There were different targets, different parameters, and we had to kind of been able to achieve to some extent. And then comes the issue of quality control, where there are slowly coming EQA vendors who are kits with different standards and low positive controls. And these low positive controls are something that will help us define our limit of quantification. And apart from all of these, it's a constant conversation that we need to have with our staff to motivate them, to remind them of why they're coming to work, and to dispel any apprehensions or fears that they may have that they're working in a COVID laboratory. So to summarize, awareness of what we are dealing with is key, and I think hysteria is counterproductive. We must ensure personal protection, and the dictum is that anything and everything is infectious until proven otherwise, and test the right people with the right tools at the right time, and we'll be safe. And also remember that this too shall pass, and hopefully we'll all be back soon. And I can't finish without expressing gratitude to my team, Dr. Sujay, Dr. Sneha, and Dr. Jairam, and the KCIIPM social media committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Antrikas. Am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, you're audible, yeah.
Thank you for that elaborate presentation on such a pertinent topic. Okay, so it was extremely well done, okay?
Thank you.
Okay, but we have a few questions here from the audience. Dr. Vaskanan from CNC Vellore wants to know whether there are any specific science on automated analyzers and in terms of fluorescence and conductivity. Could you please take that?
That's an interesting question. And Kanan, we've not got any blood samples from COVID patients as yet. So we hope that once up and the lockdown lifts, we'll be able to get some data on this. So I personally haven't looked at cell counter parameters in COVID patients as of now.
Okay, done. And Dr. Akina Prakash wants to know what are the precautions that you're following at your lab for processing other routine specimens like routine blood and urine samples? I think you covered it in your presentation, could you please summarize it for her once?
Yeah, so the general precaution is that we treat all samples or all surfaces as being infectious until proven otherwise. So biopsy containers before being opened are kind of disinfected with a spray of isopropyl alcohol for 30 seconds. Samples wherever we are making smears or where we are opening the caps, the operator wears an N95 mask and a full sleeve glove a full sleeve gown and a change of gloves. So general precautions like that. And also the fact that we've separated the COVID-19 facility from the other areas of the lab. There's a separate entrance for both staff and samples. So the staff who are involved in the COVID-19 lab do not walk into the other areas of the lab. So that way we've kind of separated the areas.
Done. Thank you. I also wanted to know about what pooled PCR testing.
Okay. So there's been a lot of discussion on pooled PCR testing. It does make sense in areas with low prevalence where we expect the positivity rate to be less than 2% because majority of the samples would be negative. And I think King George Medical University has validated this, and there's not been any compromise in the limit of quantification. As of now, it's been recommended from only these low prevalence areas where we pool 5 samples and then test them at once. And if they're negative, then all 5 are released as negative. If it is positive, all 5 are retested individually to find the positive sample.
Done. Thank you. Are you doing it at the other lab?
We haven't started doing it yet, although we've put the process in place. Start.
Okay, done. Thank you. Dr. Akina also wants to know where to discard the masks used by healthcare workers, and because of the discrepancy in guidelines regarding the same.
So again, what the guidelines is that it needs to be discarded separately in clearly marked bags, and also handed over to the biomedical waste the company who handles your biomedical waste in a separate manner. They've not mentioned about any specific ways of discarding, but I think it's generally incineration that is recommended.
Okay. Thanks a lot for that elaborate presentation, and you've taken the questions as well. I thank you and also all the audience who joined us here. And you can again watch this live. It will be on our YouTube channel. You can continue to watch it later also if you want to go back. It will be available there. I thank Dr. Anand Vikas Jairam from the Newberg Anand Reference Laboratory, Bangalore, for this presentation.
Thanks
for the presentation, and I request all the audience to know that the next webinar will be next Saturday, that is May 9th, on the Gleason's Revisited by Dr. Jairam sir from the Anand Reference Laboratory. Please do join us for that. Thank you, Anand Vikas. It was a great presentation. I will disconnect for now.